So today we'll discuss some more properties of the matrix of a linear transformation. Okay, let me recall the important result that we proved last time towards the end. V and W are finite dimensional vector spaces. Over the same field, let us say real field, T from V to W is linear. I have two ordered bases. I have two ordered bases of V and W respectively. I am using this notation for that, BV, BW. Then we had seen last time that for every x and v, if you look at the matrix of Tx, Tx is in W, the matrix of Tx relative to Vw, this is the matrix of T relative to the basis BV, BW into the matrix of X relative to BV. This is what we said is the converse of the statement that if A is a matrix, then Tx equal to Ax is a linear transformation. Okay, okay. Let us look at a few more properties of the matrix of a linear transformation, especially we will look at first how it behaves. What is the matrix of the composition of linear transformations? What is the matrix of the composition of linear transformations? What we will see is that this is the multiplication of the corresponding matrices, and this is really the defining place for matrix multiplication, something that we should always remember. Matrix multiplication, the unique peculiar way it is defined, comes really by looking at matrices as linear transformations. Okay, so the next result really defines matrix multiplication. Then we will also look at the question, if T is invertible, what, how can you compute the matrix of the inverse transformation T inverse? Okay, the natural answer is it will be the inverse, the matrix of T inverse relative to the same basis will be the inverse of the matrix of the transformation T. Okay, and also finally establish a relationship between matrices corresponding to different bases. Okay, these three results we'll discuss today. So the first is composition. So this is a framework for me. The framework is I will use a slightly different notation for this theorem. You will see it's because of its simplicity. I have U, V, W, finite dimensional vector spaces. Real vector spaces, say. With I'll write down the basis for U. So these are ordered bases. I'll write down the basis BU explicitly. I need to talk about composition of maps. So I have two maps. T is from U to V. T is from U to V, and S is from V to W. Suppose these are linear. Suppose T and S are linear. Then I am looking at the composition. First, I must define the composition. But before that, I want to write down the formula for the matrix of the composition operator. Remember, S-circle-T. S-circle-T is a map from, say, T is from U to V. So T takes a vector x from U to V. S takes that vector Tx to W. So this is a matrix from U to W. So I must write BU, BW. Okay, this is a linear transformation. This is a function in the first place from U into W. What we would like to demonstrate is that this is S. Now S is from V to W, so BV, BW into T. T is from UV, BU, BV, where I have not yet defined the composition, where S circle T of X, the composition, S circle T of X, this is equal to S of T of X, where X is in U. This is the formula for the composition. For X in U, S circle T of X is S of T of X, composition. Okay. So let us prove this result, and you will see that this really defines, see, if S and T are linear transformations, we will now show that S, it is easily seen that S circle T is a linear transformation. So we know what this matrix is. What this formula says is the matrix multiplication of the matrix of this transformation and the matrix of this transformation, the product is defined by the left hand side matrix. Okay. So this defines matrix multiplication really. Given two matrices, I can always find linear transformations S and T such that the first matrix A is this, the second matrix B is this. Then I would like to know what is AB. That is given by the composition S circle T relative to these two bases. Okay. So this is really the definition of matrix multiplication. Okay. So let us prove this. Before proving this formula, I must show that S circle T is linear, but I am going to leave that as an exercise. So proof. Clearly, composition of linear transformations is again a linear transformation. We need to observe that S circle T is a linear transformation now from U into W. Okay. Remember, this is a formula connecting to showing that two matrices are equal. Let us say I want to show matrix P is equal to matrix Q. Then I will have to show that the corresponding entries are the same. A little more general, I will show that the jth column of the matrix P is equal to the jth column of the matrix Q. Then it follows that P is equal to Q. That's what I will do. Okay. So let me start with I have written down the basis. I have written down the basis BU explicitly. I am going to exploit that. Consider S circle T of uj, S circle T of uj is a vector in w. I want to look at the matrix of this relative to bw. This is an element in w, this is a vector in w. I will appeal to this. I will appeal to this result and also use the definition of composition. So this is equal to, let me write this as it is, S of T of uj, that is composition, and then keep this BW. I have simply expanded what is inside this bracket. Now I have S of some vector. What is a matrix of S of some vector? What is a matrix of T of some vector? It is a matrix of T into that vector. Just write the appropriate basis. This is a matrix of S. Now the matrix of S, S is a function from V to W. So the matrix of S will be BV BW into the matrix of T of UJ. Okay, now matrix of T of UJ, T of UJ is from U into W. So I must remember to write this as BW. It is that correct? BV. BV. T is a function from U into V. So this is BV. TUJ BV. Apply this formula once again. So this is equal to matrix of T. T is from U to V, BU, BV, and UJ is a vector in U, BU. Is that okay? This is U. Is this okay? So what I have done is on the left I have S circle T of okay. Now I will expand the left hand side. This will be, this is another linear transformation. I can call that R if you want. So this is S circle T. S circle T is now a matrix, is now a linear transformation from U to W. UJ is in U, BU. This is my left hand side, and the right hand side I will write it as it is. Do you agree with this? S circle T is a linear transformation. So I can call that as R if you want. Then it is left hand side is R of UJ. R of UJ, I will appeal to the same formula. R of UJ is matrix of R into matrix of UJ. What is R? S circle T. So I have this. This is because R is S circle T, that is linear. Okay. The only thing that you need to observe is what is the matrix of UJ relative to the basis BU? Make that observation, we are through. Ith component 1, all other entries 0. That's a column vector. UJ, matrix of UJ relative to BU. How do you write that? You must write UJ as a linear combination of U1, U2, etc., UN. The only unique linear combination of UJ is 0 times U1 plus 0 times U2, etc., 1 into UJ plus 0 UJ plus etc., 0 UN. So the matrix of UJ relative to BU is the column vector EJ. This happens in the jth coordinate. This is what we call as EJ, the standard, the jth standard basis vector of Rn, the jth standard basis vector of Rn. This is a matrix of UJ relative to BU, relative to BU. With respect to some other basis, you won't get this. Are we through with the proof? You need to make one more observation. This observation was made much earlier. This is a matrix on the left, this is a vector. It is really EJ I have written down. So this left hand side is S circle T BU BW EJ is equal to S T EJ for all J. This is true for all J as J varies from 1 to n. What you observe is that if A is a matrix and EJ is the jth standard basis vector, A is of order m cross n, then AEJ is the jth column. EJ is the jth standard basis vector, A is an m cross n matrix, then AEJ is the jth column of A. Jth column of A on the left is the jth column of this product. If AEJ equals BEJ for all J, then A is equal to B. That's what we have. So if you want, you can call this M, you can call this as N, then I have MEJ equals NEJ for all J, jth column of M is equal to jth column of N, J arbitrary. So M is equal to N, so these two matrices must be the same, and so I have this formula. S circle T BU BW, on the right BV BW, S BU BV T. Okay, I told you this defines matrix multiplication, and we know that matrix multiplication is associative. That can be shown by using this result and one of the previous theorems. So let me just give this as a corollary. To fill up the details is an exercise for you. Matrix multiplication is associative, is a corollary of this result. Okay, one of the consequences matrix multiplication is associative. Just a few lines of this proof. Given two three matrices, matrix multiplication ABC, given three matrices ABC such that multiplication is possible, the product ABC is possible, then product AB product BC will be possible. So given three matrices ABC such that the product ABC is possible, A into BC is AB into C. That's what matrix multiplication associativity means. This you want to show A into BC equals AB into C. You are given ABC, construct three transformations TA, TB, TC such that TAX equals AX, TBX equals BX, TCX equals CX. What is the matrix of the transformation TA corresponding to the standard basis? That will be A. Matrix of TB corresponding to the standard basis, that will be B. Matrix of TC corresponding to standard basis, that will be C. Standard basis in the appropriate spaces. See, product ABC must be defined. So the number of columns of A must be the same as the number of rows of B. The number of columns of B must be the same as the number of rows of C. The order of ABC will be the number of rows of A times the number of columns of C. So you need to choose appropriate basis in appropriate spaces, K, L, M, whatever. Then use the fact that this formula holds and show that you have AB into C is A into BC. Okay, so just take matrices, write down the obvious linear natural linear transformations defined through these matrices, and look at the matrices of these linear transformations in turn with relative to the standard basis, and apply this theorem. Okay, you can show that matrix multiplication is associative. Okay, one of the other consequences is what is the inverse matrix of a linear transformation which is known to be invertible? Okay, the answer has been given. Let's prove this result. But before that, let's look at the specific case. See, we are talking about inverse transformations. In particular, we look at a linear transformation over a vector space. That is, from the vector space to itself. Consider T from V to V linear. Such a transformation will be called an operator. If the domain and the codomain are the same, then T will be called an operator. if the spaces V and W are different, then you have to obviously choose different bases. But if the spaces are the same, then it's comfortable to deal with only one basis. Okay. So let us say script B. I will not use V. There is only one vector space. Let script B be a basis of V. I won't use BV. There is only one space here. Then I will use this notation TB. There is only one basis. I will use this notation to denote TBB. See, I know how to write down the matrix of a linear transformation when two bases are given. In particular, if the bases coincide, then I know what this right hand side is. Instead of writing BB, I will simplify the notation by writing TB. Now, this I can do when I know that T is an operator, the space from the space V to itself. So, I will use this notation. This is just a notation, okay. This is just a terminology. TB will be this matrix which we know how to compute. Let us look at the particular case. So, what is the matrix of the identity transformation on V? What is the matrix of the identity transformation on V? Can you see that it is identity matrix? But if it is between two different bases, then it is not the identity matrix. Why is this identity matrix? That is because you must look at the first basis vector, write it as a linear combination of the same basis. The only choice is first coordinate is 1, all other coefficients are 0. So the first column is 1 0 0, second column is 0 1 0, etc. So the identity matrix, for the linear transformation I on V with respect to a particular fixed basis B, treating that as two different bases, is the identity matrix of order the same as a dimension of V. So for the identity transformation, if the two bases are the same, then it is identity matrix. If the bases are different, then it is not identity. You can verify easily by simple examples. Also, what is the matrix of the zero transformation relative to a single basis? That is a zero matrix, okay. Left hand side zero transformation, right hand side is a zero matrix. This is an equation involving matrices, okay. In this case, let us go back to that formula that we derived just now. I have T, S from V to itself, V linear operators. This I have proved earlier. What happens to this in this example, in this particular situation? S circle T, there is only one basis. Okay, so this is a simplified formula when you are dealing with linear operators. Now what it actually means is that a little more abstraction can be brought here. I defined the function phi from TL, recall, I defined a function phi from on a linear transformation T. So this is in LVW to R m cross n, R mn or R m cross n, by phi of T equals the transformation T relative to two bases. This time I will choose in the case when W is V, I will have only one basis. So this will be with respect to only one basis, the only basis that I started with. LVV can be shortened to LV, but I leave it as it is. We had observed that this is an isomorphism. This is linear, one to one and on to, and so it is an isomorphism. And we use this formula to compute the dimension of L VW. If V is m dimensional, W is n dimensional, then we computed the dimension of L VW by using this formula, this isomorphism. Now, if in the light of this formula, what it also follows is that this phi preserves products. Phi preserves products. What is the meaning of this? Phi of S circle T equals phi of S into phi of T. It is like Fxy equals Fx into Fy. That is called a multiplicative function. Phi preserves products. What is the consequence of this? Consequence of this formula really? The formula that I told you for the inverse transformation when you know that the inverse exists. So let us derive that next. So I want to show this result that let T from V to V be an invertible transformation linear operator. And a script B be a basis of V. Then T inverse is also a linear transformation from T inverse is also a linear operator. We had seen this before. What is the matrix of T inverse relative to B? What we want to show is that this is equal to the matrix of T relative to B, take the inverse of that. So I will introduce a bracket and write this minus 1 outside, okay. Remember this is an equation again involving matrices, equation involving matrices. What is inside the bracket are linear transformations, okay. Proof. I will make use of what we had seen just now, this formula and the fact that the identity transformation with respect to the matrix of the identity transformation relative to a fixed basis is the identity matrix. Since T is invertible, there exists S from V to V such that T is invertible, there exists S such that TS, by which I mean T circle S, okay. So T circle S is S circle T equals the identity transformation. This is a formula for transformations, there are no matrices here. S and T are linear transformations, the right hand side I is the identity transformation. So I am using the same notation, the context must make it clear. Whether it is a matrix or a linear transformation. So I will apply this formula to this equation. So if you look at T circle S relative to the fixed basis B that I started with, that will be equal to identity relative to B. I am using the first equation, T circle S equals I, am using just that. Identity relative to B is the identity matrix. This time it is an equation involving matrices. The right hand side I is the identity matrix. T circle SB, I will invoke this formula. That is a matrix of T relative to B into the matrix of S relative to B. This is equal to the identity matrix. I can do a similar thing for the second equation and just write down on the other side. This is equal to S into T, matrix of S into matrix of T. This is matrix of S into matrix of T coming from this equation. So I have two matrices, let us say A and B. A into B equals identity, that is equal to B into A. In fact, one of them is enough because it is a square matrix. Rank nullity dimension theorem could be used, okay. In any case, I have an equation like A into B equals identity, A and B are matrices. So since A is square and B is square, A and B both must be invertible. What it also means is that this SB is the inverse of this matrix. This matrix must be the inverse of this matrix. So let me write this. What in particular this means is that S, this is a matrix, remember, this must be the inverse of this matrix by definition. AB equals identity, A and B are square. So B equals A inverse, that is what I have written down. But S is T inverse. And so I have this. So you do not have to compute the matrix of the inverse transformation if you know the matrix of the original transformation. You take the inverse of the matrix of the transformation that you started with, that will be the matrix of the inverse transformation relative to the same basis that you started with. Okay. If you change the basis, then this changes. Okay, that brings us really to the next, probably the most crucial question. How do matrices corresponding to different bases behave? How do matrices corresponding to different bases behave? Okay, so let us answer that question. How do matrices corresponding to different bases for the same transformation behave? Okay. The answer is given in the next result. So let me state this theorem. So I have a single linear transformation, a linear operator really. Two bases. Let T be linear. Let T be linear. Let B1 and B2 be bases of V. Look at the identity transformation and then look at the matrix of the identity transformation relative to these two bases. Let me call that as the matrix M. I am looking at the identity linear transformation relative to, I am computing the matrix of this identity linear transformation relative to these two bases. We know that this is not I, this is not the identity matrix. I am calling that as a matrix M. Then we have the following. For every x and v, the matrix of x relative to B2, the second basis, is m times the matrix of x relative to B1. This really gives us the other formula. How are matrices of a particular linear transformation corresponding to different bases related? So let me write that formula here. The matrix of T relative to B2, by which I mean B2, is M into the matrix of T relative to B1, that is matrix of T relative to B1 times M inverse. Okay. this is the important, probably the most important relationship. Remember that this involves M inverse, so we must show that M is invertible, okay. But I am going to leave that little part as an exercise. This is similar to what we did earlier. Use the previous result, composition use the earlier result to show that M is invertible. So I am going to leave this part as an exercise. Exercise, show that M is invertible. Remember, M is a matrix. To show that M is invertible, one could, for instance, show that the system Mx equal to 0 for x in Rn, if n is a dimension of V, has x equal to 0 as the only solution. Mx equal to 0 for x in Rn has x equal to 0 as the only solution. Now that you can use this idea to prove that M is invertible. So I will assume M is invertible and derive this formula, but this formula is really a consequence of this formula. So we need to prove this first, okay. So let us prove this. Let us start with the matrix of X relative to B2. I can write this as the matrix of identity X, identity transformation, X relative to B2, and then use this formula that we proved earlier. Let me recall that here. Matrix of Tx relative to B2, Bw actually, that is a matrix of T relative to B1, B2 into matrix of X relative to B1. This is what we proved earlier. We used Bv, Bw. This is Bw, Bv, Bw, Bv. I am using B1, B2 here. Vector space V is the same, two different bases now. So let me use this result. Here, this is the matrix of I relative to B1, B2 into the matrix of X relative to B1. I have the first formula immediately, right? This is what we are denoting by M. So XB2 is MXB1. That has proved the first formula, okay. XB2 is identity transformation I am applying, and then I am appealing to this formula. Matrix of I relative to B1, B2, and then matrix of X relative to B1. This is what we are calling as M. So I have the first formula. XB2 is MXB1, that is the first formula. I need to prove this. So let me now start with consider Tx B2, Tx B2. I am going to appeal to the previous formula. Let me call Tx as Y, then I am looking at Y relative to B2. Y relative to B2 is M times Y relative to B1. Y relative to B2 is M times Y relative to B1. Instead of Tx, I have Y. Y relative to B2 is M times Y relative to B1. Tx B1, I will apply this formula. With the B2 replacing B1, with B1 equals B2 really. I will apply this formula with B1 equals B2. This formula holds for any two bases, in particular B1 equals B2. So I am going to look at this formula. Tell me if this statement is clear. I will write this as M. Do you agree with this? That is, I am looking at a single basis now. I am looking at a single basis, and then I am looking at this formula for a single basis. M into T B1 into X B1. That is, it is actually matrix of T B1 B1 into matrix of X B1. The formula for a single basis, I am using that. But matrix of T B1 B1 is what we are denoting as T B1, matrix of T relative to B1. On the left hand side, I have Tx B2, I will use that formula for B2. See, I have really got what I wanted on the right hand side. So I want this. I have sort of got of what I want really here. I will now expand this Tx B2 for a single basis. B2 will be T B2 B2. That is just T B2. Is it okay? Same thing. Tx B2. What I did here, I have what I have done here. I have used for B2, then invoke the first formula. TB2 into the first formula is XB2 is M, XB1. I hope it is clear. I start with TXB2, apply this formula for as though there is a single basis. So as a single basis, I get this formula B2, and then formula 1, XB2 is M times XBN, I proved it. So I invoke that here. So finally, what do I have? That is, this is on the left, TB2 M XB1, this is on the left, that is expanded form of this. On the right, I have this, so let me write this, M TB1 XB1. I want to show two matrices are equal. I will show that their jth columns are equal. This is true for all X in V that I started with. This is true for all X in V. In particular, I am looking at XB1. In particular, take B1, write down explicitly, let us say U1, U2, etcetera, UN, and then look at X being replaced by U1, U2, U3, etcetera. Let us say X being replaced by uj, if I replace X by uj and write the matrix relative to that same basis, then this is a jth column. This is something that we did just now. Instead of X, replace them by the basis elements that are present in B1, then I will get TB2M is M TB1. This is true for all X. Apply it to the basis elements, I get this. Again, something like PEJ equals QEJ. So jth column of P is equal to jth column of Q. So P is equal to Q. This whole thing is P for me. This is a matrix. So remember, M is a matrix. This is a matrix. This is a product I am calling P. This whole thing is again a matrix. I am calling that Q. I will apply the basis elements in B1 to this equation. Then this will be the first column of the identity matrix, second column of the identity matrix, etcetera. So these two matrices are the same. Invoke the fact that M is invertible, post multiply by M inverse, I get the required formula. Since M is invertible, I can post multiply this equation by M inverse. This is now an equation involving matrices. So I have TB2 equals M TB1 M inverse, okay. That is, if P is, okay, let us say if A is a matrix of a linear transformation corresponding to one basis and B is the matrix of a linear transformation corresponding to another basis, then A and B are related by the formula A equals M times B times M inverse for some invertible matrix M. If A is a matrix of a linear transformation corresponding to one basis, B is a matrix of the same linear transformation corresponding to another basis, then A and B are related by the formula A equals MB M inverse for some invertible matrix M. How one could determine M is a different matter, but there is an invertible matrix M that satisfies this equation. Such, okay. Can you see that if A equal to MB M inverse, then B is equal to M inverse A M, that is M inverse A, M inverse inverse. Instead of M inverse, let us use N. Then if A is equal to MB M inverse, then B is equal to N A N inverse. Okay. So we can, if A is related to B by means of this formula, we say that B is similar to A. If A is related to B by means of this formula, we say B is similar to A. By the observation that we have seen just now, it follows that if B is similar to A, then A is similar to B. Okay. A is similar to itself. A is equal to identity A, identity inverse. If A is similar to B, B is similar to C, product of inverses you can use to show that A is similar to C. So this is an equivalence relation. Similarity of matrices is an equivalence relation. What does it preserve? That is something we cannot discuss right now. It preserves what are called eigenvalues. It preserves eigenvalues. Okay, that is something we will discuss later. Let me stop here.